Shifting gears a little bit from the talks and the wording, although obviously closely related in the sense that this paper is going to be taking more of a household perspective on things and kind of drilling down to thinking about detailed consumption patterns of individual products and sort of thinking about product entry and the implications of trends that I'm going to show you for thinking about welfare and market power implications and things along those lines. So essentially, we're going to document two, I think, pretty striking trends in detailed product-level consumption patterns for individual households, two divergent trends that together we're going to call this increase in niche consumption, and then think about the implications of these patterns and the potential forces driving. So let me just show you the patterns. This slide has kind of the two different views of what we're going to call the first trend, and then the next slide I'll show you will be the second related trend. So the first fact that I want to argue, and I'll go through the constructions of these things in a little bit more detail in four or five slides and talk about the underlying data. But the first fact that we show is that what we call household level product concentration has increased fairly substantially over the last 12 or so years. So what do I mean by household level product consumption? What we're going to do is we're going to
one particular
category, like say yogurt, and we're going to focus on, you know, an individual household in that product category. We can measure all of the spending in a year that a household is going to do across all of the different yogurt UPCs. That'll give us individual household product spending shares. And then from those things, you can then calculate different concentration measures. So the primary thing we're going to focus on is going to be the Herfindahl. So household concentration is increasing over this time frame. A flip side of that is if you look at the average number of varieties that households are purchasing within particular narrow product categories, that has been declining. You know, so just to make sure that we're sort of fixed on what the ideas are here and, you know, what this household Herfindahl measure is capturing. You know, suppose in 2004, one particular household split their yogurt spending equally between Dannon and Yoplait, and then in 2016, they had switched to doing all of their spending on Chobani. We would call that like a large increase in household level spending concentration. So this is our first fact, that household concentration has gone up. One potential natural explanation for this, I think, especially in this audience, given the literature on the firm side, would be if these are sort of superstar products in the economy. Like maybe there are really great products that are being created and household spending is kind of all shifting towards those, you know, particularly appealing products. But it turns out if you measure aggregate product concentration, which is kind of exactly the same concept, but here we're gonna add up all of the spending across households on products within categories. So, you know, we're just calculating market shares in a slightly more aggregated way now. If you measure aggregate product concentration, that's actually been going down fairly substantially over this same period of time. So households are concentrating their spending more and purchasing less varieties on average, but the aggregate economy is spreading its spending across the product space more equally, and the number of varieties in aggregate that are being purchased within categories is going up. So you have these two divergent trends. How do we think about kind of reconciling these just mechanically? Well, the first trend is kind of showing you that households increasingly like their top products more in some sort of revealed spending sense. But the second fact is sort of then also implying that households increasingly differ on the identities of those top products. So households are sort of sorting into different products, but these products are all differing from each other. So the product space is kind of fragmenting more. And this is what we think of, or what we call growing niche consumption in the economy. So we think of this as kind of another dimension of growing fragmentation that just joins a host of kind of phenomena documented in different parts of the economy. So we don't want to say that it's, you know, in any way related to any of these other things, or it's just sort of like, you know, another mechanism of heterogeneity that's showing up in the economy. So we're seeing, you know, fragmentation of sort of digital content has been well documented, like thinking about long tail stuff in online markets. There's increasing political polarization, increasing job polarization. And here we're just showing that this sort of long tail niche consumption thing that's mainly received attention in digital markets is also kind of manifesting itself in some sense in more brick and mortar kind of retailers and more traditional product market spaces.
This sounds pretty sensitive to market definition.
In what sense? Or what do you mean?
Yeah, talking about concentration, not defining the market.
Yeah, so this is all going to be sort of concentration things measured at within particular product categories. You can do all of the results at various different levels of aggregation within the Nielsen data that we're going to be using, and it doesn't make really any difference for the broad trends that we're talking about, but it's all going to be, yeah, some sort of notion of within particular categories.
That all food categories, Jerry Hausman would tell you that all different kinds of food compete in the same relevant market. That would change the conclusion, surely.
Even if you compute, I'm not sure if you aggregate all the way up to sort of just all of the Nielsen products as a whole and recompute these measures, whether the trends go through, but you can do this at like reasonably high levels of aggregation within the Nielsen data and you still get these divergent trends.
Yes, like you're trying to say this as a matter of preference could just be a matter of like knowledge. It's just easier for me to find my top products. Before I would go to the grocery store.
At this stage of the presentation and kind of level of analysis, I'm not saying anything about what the drivers of this are. This is just a statement about trends in consumption patterns in the data. I'm taking no stand on what's driving these trends. I'm just saying, what?
No, just get really like their content.
Yeah, that's what I said it in words, just in a revealed preference sense, that households are increasingly, they're spending more on their top products. So maybe like is not the right word to use there. Okay, so I think it's helpful to kind of fix ideas to drill down just in like a few different particular product categories and just give you a sense of kind of what this phenomenon looks like in some particular case studies. So each of these is kind of like a different product category, and what I'm showing here is the things in the top in each of these categories are some of the initial top market share items that have then subsequently lost the most market share over the 12 years that we're going to have in our data set. And then what I'm showing in the bottom row is at least some of the products that are replacing some of that market share. So some of the products that are growing market share fairly substantially over this same period of time. And there's sort of a lot of heterogeneity across product categories, you know, in exactly how this phenomenon's kind of working. But you can see like in the carbonated beverages category, Coke has lost a lot of, and Pepsi have lost, you know, market share. One of the big entrants in this category is energy drinks. So those are capturing much more market share now, and they're kind of, you know, differentiated in some dimension from the incumbents. The category that I find sort of the example that I find the most informative is looking at like the tortilla chips category. If you look at that, kind of regular Tostitos is the brand that lost the most market share over this period. And what products replaced that market share? Well, the two of the products that gained the most market share are Tostitos Scoops and Tostitos Cantita. So it's kind of like different products. I talked to Mark when he was out visiting about this, and he said that, well, obviously Tostitos Scoops are better. I never purchased Tostitos Scoops, so I have a different preference there. What you see is that, you know, in all these categories, kind of the total number of varieties are going up and aggregate concentration in these categories are going down. But kind of consistent with that argument, households have different preferences for these kind of things, and households aren't evenly spreading their spending over these categories. So like Mark only purchases Scoops, I only purchase the kind of original Tostitos. And so you're getting these two phenomena coexisting with each other, that the aggregate marketplace is becoming more evenly spread out, even as individual households are just, you know, sorting into one of these products and only purchasing that one.
But Joe, yep. Can it just be like, so they still, at least to me, the three things look very similar to each other, and it's because they're literally kind of flipping a coin. So it's nothing about, I mean, you have three, before it was one, so you grab one, now it's three, and I just go and grab whatever.
Well, that's what I was trying to emphasize with what I just said about the fact that household concentration in these categories is going up. So in the sense of, you know, just based on what individual households are purchasing in the data, it doesn't look like households are indifferent between these things and they're just flipping a coin. Because if they were just flipping a coin, you would expect that, I mean, here we're all of our spending measures are going to be kind of aggregated spending annually and averaging over those things. So if you were just flipping a coin, you would expect that you know, sometimes they would go
I thought it was
way.
Just, okay, got it.
Yeah, so this is going to be over some like time frame that's a little bit more aggregated. So that's going to be the basic empirical facts. I'll show you them in a little bit more detail and some additional cuts of those things. And then the second half of the paper is going to be building a model to try to understand what's driving this phenomenon and to think about the implications for welfare and for market power. So the key things that we think we want to have in our model, we want this model to have endogenous numbers of varieties that households are consuming. So households are going to choose how many varieties they're going to consume in this model. But we also want to be able to capture the fact that in the data, it's not the case that, you know, if I just tell you the number of varieties that a household purchases, that households split their spending evenly over all the things they're purchasing. So you want to be able to capture the fact that, you know, even after I tell you that a household purchases 5 brands of yogurt, they're within those 5, they're going to spend a lot on one of them and they're going to spend not so much on the other 4. So you want to be able to capture that kind of phenomenon, that spending is very skewed within the things households purchase. And we want to take seriously the fact that different households consume different varieties from each other. So we're not in sort of a representative agent world, and there's, you know, substantial heterogeneity in the data. So I think basically all of the sort of vanilla off-the-shelf models that we could think of are going to miss, you know, one or more of these different facts. So we're going to have to kind of expand on some of the existing literature. So if you just think about sort of standard love of variety CES kind of models, at least in sort of symmetric versions of those, the household Herfindahl is just going to be equal to 1 over the number of products that households purchase. So you're not going to capture this second fact. And without heterogeneity, you're not going to capture this third fact. You could think about discrete choice models. Discrete choice models, at least in sort of a literal sense, are just going to imply that households are only going to purchase a single good. You know, you can imagine sort of time aggregated versions of discrete choice models with sort of shocks across time. I think that would be a totally reasonable direction of going. It's not the model that we're going to write down, but it's something we've thought about doing.
But those models would typically have heterogeneity of preferences, which would give you shares.
Yeah, so you would have heterogeneity of, but if you just, I mean, all I'm saying is take a literal discrete choice model where households only purchase 1 item, then the household Herfindahl is going to be 1 by definition in that model. So you'd have to extend it at least a little bit in some dimension.
You have several people in that.
Yeah, so you can do that, but one of the cuts of the data that I'll show you or talk about is, I mean, you can do all these things conditional on household size, and you see this even for single person households. And then any sort of representative household model is just by definition going to always have the household concentration equal to the aggregate concentration. So just kind of like by assumption, these trends are going to be equal to each other. So we're going to write down this model. It's going to be relatively flexible in its ability to match these things, but it's still going to be set up in a way with pretty strong functional form assumptions that I'll try to show you, like, do a reasonable job of fitting the data. But we're able to get a bunch of analytical closed form solutions for both household and aggregate concentration out of the model, and then derive pretty concrete implications about what the underlying driving trends that can have scope to explain these things are. Essentially, there's going to be one particular thing that's kind of the model really cries out through the lens of this model that we need to explain these divergent trends. And that's going to be like either an expansion of the number of available products, you know, which you can sort of microfound through a decline in the innovation cost if you want, or just an increase in idiosyncratic preferences or idiosyncratic tastes for products. In the way that we're going to write down the model, these are going to be isomorphic things for everything that would be observable. So there's not sort of any direct way of differentiating these things in the model. But what I'll show you in the data is we see these phenomena within very narrow demographic groups. So to me, I find the sort of declining innovation costs and expanding product space story much more appealing. But, you know, up front, they're isomorphic, so we can't really directly distinguish them. And then what we're going to get, at least if it's coming through this kind of declining innovation costs and expanding number of varieties out there, is this is going to imply substantial welfare gains that are going to come from essentially a novel selection effect term in the ideal price index, that households are going to, when there's more products out there, you can fill the basket of goods that you're going to be purchasing with a set of products that's sort of more tailored to your unique preferences, and that's going to be a positive effect for welfare.
So this differs from Spence's foundational paper on this subject, which whose fundamental conclusion was that the welfare effects could go either way. But you get an assigned welfare effect.
So we're going to get an assigned welfare effect, you know, with the sort of structure and functional forms that we're writing down, which, again, I'll, you know, show her a reasonable fit for the data, but the functional forms we're writing down are in some sense driven by analytical tractability, so I don't want to, you know, say anything too strong that, like, this would have to go through with, you know, any functional forms that you might write down.
From your perspective, whether Spence was right or wrong?
I don't want to make any strong stance on that. I haven't thought through carefully, like, the relationship between any results that he has and ours, so I don't want to, you know, go on the record with anything there. Okay, so let me show you the facts first, and then I'll jump into the details of the model. So in terms of the data that we're going to be using, this is Nielsen home scan data from 2004 now we've done it through 2016. So basically this data set is primarily covering sort of the consumer packaged goods stuff in the economy, mostly grocery store spending stuff. So that's kind of the way to think about the products that are in this data set. In terms of the sample that we're going to do, we're, you know, including all households, we're going to focus on stuff that's barcoded. In the baseline things I'm going to show you, we're going to be throwing out generic store brand items, but you can do everything with store brands in there. It doesn't really make any difference. And we're going to be focusing on a balanced set of product categories across time so that things aren't driven by, you know, which categories Nielsen is or isn't sampling across time. The results I'm going to show you are defining a product as a UPC, but you can also define a product in a little bit more aggregated way as a brand, and it doesn't change any of the results. And, you know, as Bob sort of asked, obviously market shares are going to depend on how you define the market. So our baseline notion of sort of a category that we're calculating spending shares within is these 107 categories in the Nielsen data, which are like carbonated beverages or laundry supplies. You can do everything sort of more disaggregated. You can do everything more aggregated, and it doesn't really change any of the patterns.
A demand model answers market definition, right?
If we are estimating elasticities and things like that, which we are not. I mean, we're just calculating spending shares.
That doesn't apply. You can't read the cross-elasticity stuff.
Read the cross elasticities
well,
off
normally,
of.
Normally, all the products belong in the same market are those that have high cross price elasticities.
I mean, if we had exogenous price variation to estimate those cross price elasticities, then sure. I mean, otherwise, you're going to have to estimate.
So, like, you can't read anything in terms of.
I don't think you can read anything off without making, like, pretty strong assumptions about things. Yeah.
How do you get welfare here?
But, I mean, the welfare conclusions are going to come out of the model. It's not anything directly about, it's not anything that's sort of directly read off the data about elasticities or anything like that. I mean, hopefully it'll be clear when I show you what we do. Yeah.
When the kids go off to college, there's less people in the household. Is that an issue? Do you control for that in any way? Household size, composition?
Let me come back to that when I sort of break down, you know, what things do and don't explain this. One of the things we'll talk about is household size. It's not important for understanding these phenomena. It's super important in levels, but not for trends things. Okay, so the only last thing to note is that in all the results I'm going to show you, we're going to be, I'm going to calculate these concentration measures, you know, within particular categories, and then there's like a question of aggregating these things up. So we're going to be averaging these category level things up to get some aggregate average. And I'm going to do that using constant category spending weights across time. So the way to think about this is we're not going to, you know, say if the economy, if spending switches from a whole bunch of spending on like yeast that only has 6 products to a whole bunch of spending on candy bars that has like 1,000 products, we're not going to call that a change in concentration. We're just capturing kind of the within category stuff. And I already sort of alluded this when I put up on the first slide. So our notion of household concentration is going to be within categories for each household. We'll calculate product spending shares and Herf and Dolls, as opposed to aggregate concentration, where we're going to add up all households' product spending and calculate product spending shares and Herf and Dolls. So I already showed you what the facts look like, just putting them up again. Here's household concentration. Here I'm just adding, you know, an alternative measure of concentration. This is the share of spending that households do on their top product, but it kind of trends in a very similar way. So household concentration is going up. You know, I already sort of noted a natural explanation for this would be kind of superstar products, but that's not what the economy seems to look like, because aggregate product concentration is going down across time. I kind of already said in the data description that this holds whether you define a product as a UPC or a brand. This is really pervasive across product categories and across geographic locations within the U.S. So this phenomenon holds in something like 90-95% of product categories. And this isn't, you know, an urban, rural thing, something like that. This holds also in like every city that we have in the data set. It even holds within most individual retailers in the data that we have. So, you know, I could calculate these market shares instead of at the level of categories. I could calculate them at the level of categories within particular retailers and redo all of the results. And all of this phenomenon basically goes through. You know, there's more heterogeneity and more noise once you're calculating market shares within individual retailers, but the basic phenomenon goes through. I think most importantly for when I'm going to interpret things in the model and try to distinguish changing tastes from changing numbers of products, we see this phenomenon going on essentially within all of the different demographic cuts along observables that we see in the Nielsen data. So it's kind of important here, I think, to note in fixing ideas. You know, the way to think about this, it's not a rich versus poor thing. It's not rich and poor people becoming more different from each other in their consumption. You know, it's not a college, non-college. It's not a black versus white. We basically see these trends going on within all of these very narrow demographic groups. So it's sort of a very fine-grained cuts of the data. You still see this as a kind of within-group trend across time. Now, that's not to say that these things kind of don't matter. Some of these things matter a lot in levels. I didn't put household size up there, but like the strongest predictor of concentration is just the number of people in a household. But you know, it's not surprising. Larger households have lower concentration. But you can see, even within fixing a household size or just focusing on households with only one person, you still see these same divergent trends going on. The one observable that sort of is kind of important for explaining these trends is stuff about product churn or kind of extensive margin effects in two different senses. So one is that I can recalculate all of these trends, but just do it only looking at a balanced set of products across time. So just calculate market shares over sets of products that are available, you know, either from 1 year to the next or available over the entire sample. If you do things that way, all of these trends are much more muted. So you don't see nearly as much increase in household concentration. You don't see nearly as much decline in aggregate concentration. The other thing I can do is, I told you that you see this phenomenon going on within a bunch of retailers in the data set. And it turns out that these trends are strongest, actually, in the retailers that have the most variety growth. So if you look at retailers where varieties are growing more rapidly, you see aggregate concentration going down more. That's maybe not super surprising, but you also see household concentration going up more in those retailers. So those are the basic empirical facts. So in the rest of the time, I'll talk about the model that we use to try to understand them and think about what's driving these results. So the basic idea of the model, it's going to be, in some sense, a modest departure from a CES environment on the household side. And then there's going to be kind of additional elements that we're going to think about for bringing in aggregation and talking about these aggregate concentration measures. So the way that we're going to model things is that there's going to be a continuum of households in the economy, and they're going to have some spending on goods that are indexed from 0 to n, where n is the number of available products in the economy. Over those goods, households are going to have CES preferences. So they're going to sort of have an elasticity of demand across all of the varieties that they choose to consume of sigma. So it's, you know, just standard CES preferences. And then there's going to be two things that we add to this model. This is sort of not particularly novel just on its own. There are some other papers out there adding the same
structure to this individual household demand problem. So one thing that we're going to add is we're going to add fixed costs of consuming some mass of varieties, you know, with some elasticity epsilon here. So this thing here is basically just going to generate an interior solution for the quantity of varieties that households are going to purchase. So households are not going to purchase all of the available varieties, you know, up to N. They're only going to purchase a subset of the available varieties in the economy. That's the first thing that we're going to do. That on its own is going to be enough to endogenize how many varieties households purchase in the model. You know, it's not endogenizing it in like a super deep way, but we basically have this fixed cost of purchasing varieties, and that's going to keep households from purchasing everything. Then the second thing that we're going to introduce to be able to match this fact that, you know, conditioning on the set of varieties that households purchase, conditioning on omega, household spending on different products is not just 1 over omega in the data. So we want to be able to capture in sort of a flexible way the fact that households spend a lot more on their top product than they do on their second product and they do on their third product. So the way we're going to capture that is we're going to assume that tastes adjusted by prices are going to be distributed according to a Pareto distribution. So the key parameter in this distribution is going to be this theta, where the larger theta is, it means the flatter the distribution of tastes that households have. So as you lower theta to be lower and lower, households are going to like their top product much more than their second product and much more than their third product. And as you raise theta, this is going to flatten out. Yeah, Tim?
It's cool. We were making an assumption about the price, which is endogenous,
right?
Object. It's primitive.
So
fair enough. So the approach for the way we're going to kind of go about modeling things is we're taking sort of the household perspective to start, and we're going to just be thinking about the household demand system given some distribution of prices, and that's kind of going to be the starting point. I'm going to derive a bunch of implications from that, sort of taking this price distribution as exogenous. Then I'm going to, towards the end of the talk about sort of the determination of prices and think about endogenizing markups and things like that. I think we have some interesting things to say there. And then the last step that's still a bit work in progress, so I won't have any results to talk about today, is kind of if we instead made the distribution of tastes kind of the primitive in the economy, then tried to layer this endogenous markup on top of it and then derive implications for prices. You know, can we generate this Pareto distribution? And can we do so in a way where we keep the distribution of tastes kind of constant across time and just change things about the number of products and kind of derive all this in equilibrium? And I think the answer is we can, at least kind of approximately in simulation. But, you know, for these analytical solutions, what I've got for now is taking this price distribution as exogenous and then just looking at the implications for spending patterns.
There's nothing unorthodox about making utility a function of price. That's just an indirect utility.
I'm not saying there's anything unorthodox about that. It's just that I'm going to have a model that's going to imply endogenous markups that vary in interesting ways. And then if I want to fix the distribution of prices to maintain Pareto, then, you know, as markups are moving around, you're going to have some taste moving around in the background to, you know, maintain this Pareto price distribution. So this is the basic setup then. You can stick, given these assumptions, under this Pareto distribution, you can derive a price index by just sticking this in sort of the standard way. With a little bit of algebra, you get this solution for the price index out that I think has these three terms that are sort of separately interpretable. So the first two terms here are kind of standard and would show up, you know, even in a situation where you didn't have these Pareto preferences in the background. There's going to be some term that's just sort of capturing something like the average price in the economy. Then there's going to be an additional term that's capturing like love for variety sort of effects that are going to come out of any of these standard CES type models. And then the term that's new that comes about from having this Pareto distribution on the taste for different products is this term that we're calling selection effects. So omega here is the number of varieties that a household is purchasing. N is the total number of varieties that are available in the economy. So what this is saying is that there's going to be this positive welfare effect holding omega constant, holding the amount of varieties that households purchase constant as you increase the number of varieties that are available in the economy, assuming households don't have symmetric preferences over all varieties, so as long as theta is not equal to infinity. And the intuition for this is, again, that, you know, if households have this Pareto distribution with sort of very skewed tastes, then the chance that they can find, you know, and suppose they purchase, you know, only a single product, the chance that the single product that really maximizes their tastes is one that's available in the economy is relatively low if the number of products n in the economy is one or two. Whereas if there are millions of products out there in the economy, the chance a household can fill their basket with a product they particularly like is going to be much higher, and that's going to be a positive welfare effect.
Apple cinnamon Cheerios. What
I'm
talking about?
A solution to it? What do you mean?
So Jerry Hausman has a famous paper on placing a value of the entry of apple cinnamon Cheerios to this market. It would be interesting to see.
Yeah, how we sort of compare to that.
Controversial paper. But it must have a mechanism similar to what you're just talking about.
Yeah, I mean, I think it's going to be closely related. Again, I haven't thought about exactly the relationship, but it's, yeah, worth thinking about.
It's certainly speaking to similar things. Yeah, I mean, sort of what's the gain from having new varieties available in the economy through things that are particularly tailored to your tastes. So that's the basic setup. The optimal number of varieties, you know, you can derive a closed form solution for this just by maximizing the omega subject to these fixed cost of purchases. There's nothing in particular that I want you to take away from this formula aside just from the fact that we have, you know, a closed form formula for this, so we can map structural parameters into choices of number of varieties. For notation moving forward over the next couple of slides, the only thing that's kind of important is I'm going to now define this gamma star as kind of the cutoff taste whose variety is going to satisfy, you know, that omega over n is equal to 1 minus g. So this is basically just defining kind of a cut of this Pareto distribution where you're going to consume all of the draws of tastes that are larger than gamma star, and you're not going to consume the products that are less than that. So given this, we can write down then, you can derive a formula for household spending shares across different products, which I didn't do in the interest of time for the talk today. And then you can calculate the household Herfindahl by just taking those individual market shares that you get over the product space of products that individual households consume, square that and integrate that, and that's going to give you the household Herfindahl. It turns out that it delivers this pretty simple closed form solution after a fair amount of algebra to get there, where basically everything comes down to essentially these two parameters. 1 over omega, which is not surprising that that's going to show up. This in the symmetric world, that would just be the household Herfindahl, right? So that's going to say if I consume 10 products and I go to 20 products, there's going to be some force that's going to, you know, have the Herfindahl. Then there's this additional term that's just a function of sigma, which is, again, this elasticity of substitution, and theta, which is this Pareto parameter and how concentrated our tastes are. And the model implies that, you know, there's some very specific functional form where these two things relate to each other. We only care about you know, the net contribution of these two things through how they show up in this particular parameter eta. So it's sort of like a net curvature term kind of in utility that shows up. So that's the household Herfindahl. We have kind of closed form solutions for that then. And it sort of tells you that, you know, even though there's various different structural parameters in this model, like there was that F and there was that epsilon, we have sigma and theta, all these things kind of map down that a bunch of these things are only going to affect Herfindahls to the extent that they change the number of varieties households consume. And then there's going to be this curvature term that's going to sort of affect things along the intensive margin.
Yep.
So here, like, every good is produced, but we all have different measures, we all have different omegas, that they might not be the same.
So I haven't yet gotten anything about how we're going to think about heterogeneity in this economy. This is still just focused on one individual household. But previewing where we're going to go, all households in the economy, the way we're going to model things, every household's going to be identical in some sense. So we'll all have the same omegas. We're all going to have the same expenditures and so on. What's going to differ is the particular identities of the goods that we're going to consume. So we're going to rank different products differently from each other. Yeah, Mark?
I mean, a big part of the fact seemed to be that at some point, Mark couldn't eat Scoops Doritos because they didn't exist, which seems kind of different to okay, at some point in time there were both scoops and whatever the other ones were, and you were both kind of choosing to consume different amounts of both of them, and now you're kind of localizing your consumption to just one of them?
So I'm not sure I understand exactly. There's going to be an expansion. We're going to think about the scoops not being available versus scoops now being available is, you know, N went up. So suppose N was 1 before and we only had regular Tostitos, and then N goes to 2, and the new thing that comes in is the scoops. That would be where we think of product entry.
Then there's the number of broader set of goods that's staying constant. So are you done?
The broader set of goods. I'm not sure.
Are you done talking about the data, or are you going to go back to the data?
I'll go back to the data and sort of think about how we map these things together.
Consuming less variety within a category, but they're consuming more categories at the same time, I assume, right, over time.
Well, all the data stuff that I showed you is sort of restricting, is you doing things for a constant number of categories and keeping spending on these categories constant. So
it's not that, like,
so think of this as a model of just spending within a particular
category.
Yeah.
So it's not that, like, if I'm only eating peanut butter for lunch every day, then I can have 2 types of peanut butter and I can get through it before they spoil. But if I have peanut butter and lunch and meat, then obviously I can't store so many types of each.
Yeah, so I don't think that's the way to think about what we're trying to model.
I think of this as just a model for one particular category. Yeah. Okay,
so this, you know, assumption that we put on the preferences that the distribution of tastes essentially follows this Pareto distribution, in some sense is like totally arbitrary, right? Like we could have written down a bunch of different possible specifications for demand. It has analytical convenience. But what we want to do with this slide, and I don't have time to talk through the details of all these things, but it's just to get some sense of whether this is kind of a good fit for the data or not, this Pareto distribution on preferences that we're writing down. And I think it's like a surprisingly good fit given especially how parsimonious it is. So the model implies like a bunch of different restrictions on different things that should come out. But one particular thing it implies is that if we look at, you know, individual households and calculate their Herfindahls and then relate them to the number of varieties that they consume, this should just be, you know, in logs, a log linear relationship with some constant that will depend on this eta. And so like here's a bin scatter of these plots. You know, so there's millions of observations in this because we have 100,000 households in a bunch of different categories, but this is just plotting you averages of those things. So the data, the linear fit from the data is the red line. The model implied slope should be 1, which would be this dashed black line. The model's obviously not a perfect fit to the data, but I think it's like a pretty good job. And then you can also you know, look at this in terms of like R squareds across different households and do various like restricted things and look at variation in these intercepts and things like that. I think the upshot of this is just that I think the fit of this model, given that we wrote it down just for analytical convenience, is like extremely much better than I was expecting it to be. Okay, so now let me talk about how we add heterogeneity and try to get to the welfare implications. So the way that we're going to model heterogeneity is we're going to assume all households in some sense are identical to each other. So every household has the same parameters. But where households are going to differ, so households are going to all have the same Pareto distribution for taste. So they're all going to like their first, their top product relative to their second product as much as they like their second product relative to their third and so on. But what's going to differ across households is the exact identity of those products. So, you know, like Chobani might have a large taste draw for some households and not for others. So it's going to be the particular identities of the products that differ across households. We're going to assume that each household ranks products from favorite to least according to this linear rank function, where J is some common aggregate rank and X is some idiosyncratic rank for that household that's distributed over the entire product space. So you know, some special cases here. So if we set alpha equal to 0, then we're getting rid of this idiosyncratic term and all households have the same ranking for products. So we're back in representative agent world. If alpha is really large, then preferences are very idiosyncratic and households like different things. So given this, the economy is going to be characterized by some threshold good that we call J star that's going to be sort of the last ranked product in the aggregate that's still consumed. And then there's going to be
some massive additional products from this J star to N, which we think of as failed products. They basically aren't good enough to get any household to consume those things. Then related to that, there's going to be some idiosyncratic draw XJ star that's going to be the worst idiosyncratic draw for a product, yielding positive consumption. So I'm getting short on time, so I won't really talk through the derivation of this then. But you can aggregate these things up, and you still get very nice closed-form solutions for aggregate market shares then. And then we can, again, take the squares of these and integrate them over the product space and get out an aggregate Herfindahl from this model. So the key thing about, and again, if we take those aggregate Herfindahls to the data and sort of estimate these things, either category by category or look in the aggregate, we can look at how well our model does at matching aggregate spending shares. And again, I think it does a pretty good job overall. So the blue line is stuff in the data, the red line is implications from our model. It doesn't work in every category. Like there's ones that we miss, like greeting cards. Our model doesn't do a very good job of explaining those consumption patterns. But again, the point of this slide is just to argue that our model is a pretty good fit for the data. Now, in the last couple minutes that I have, I want to talk about the implications for these trends. And then I just want to show one thing about elasticities. I won't have time to talk through in detail on it. So the exercise that we're going to use for the model is given these implications now, we have a closed-form solution for the household Herfindahl, and we have a closed-form solution for the aggregate Herfindahl. We can take these things, and we now have observables in the data for the aggregate Herfindahl. We have observables for the household Herfindahl, and we have observables for the number of varieties that households purchase. This lets us directly back out then a time series for the implied eta from the model, as well as a time series for the implied alpha tilde, which is a super important parameter that I kind of skipped over. It's just this function of alpha, how much heterogeneity there is in the economy, and N, the number of products that are available. So this is the sense in which I said those two different things earlier in the talk are isomorphic to each other, because they only enter the model through this product term here. So we can back out the implied values of these things, and the upshot of the model is that it implies you need a very large increase in alpha tilde to be able to rationalize this divergence that we see in the data between household concentration and aggregate concentration.
But this is like in one product category or for?
This is just calculating for the averages. We can do the same exercise category by category, but this is just how do you match those two aggregate trends that I put up in the first slide.
Could you get some information about the trend in N from your data? Like maybe looking at across.
Yeah, so we've done things with that. I mean, there's a subtlety here that what we measure in the data would be the interpretation of J star, which is not exactly the same as N, but you can kind of back out things along those lines and look at.
You see it.
Yeah, so we basically see if you look kind of category by category at the trends at the categories that have the largest increases in the number of varieties, they have pretty consistent like implications for this divergence between household and aggregate Herfindahls in those categories in the way predicted by the model. Okay, so that's what our model implies is sort of driving this divergence. So that's kind of a conclusion. One is that you need alpha up or N up. The pervasiveness of this phenomenon within groups to us suggests this product N increasing is probably more persuasive than that preferences are getting more and more differentiated within narrow demographic groups. But we can't necessarily distinguish those things. A second conclusion is that we do need other shocks. Since an increase in N all on its own would imply that the number of varieties households would be purchasing would go up, which is counterfactual. But our model kind of also suggests things about that would be consistent with explaining the data. So let me talk about the welfare changes, and then I want to skip ahead just to show you elasticities in the model, because I think we have an interesting result, and that'll be the end of my time. So consider an increase in N around 70%, like I imputed before. This is then going to imply various welfare effects through the lens of the model, which we can decompose into different channels. So there's going to be love for variety effects, which are modestly positive. You're increasing the number of varieties you'll purchase, so there's going to be negative fixed cost effects, which are also relatively small. And then there's these large selection effect gains. And the overall net effect in welfare is fairly substantial, mostly coming through this selection effect. So I'm out of time, so let me just say one last thing, which is, Herfindahls classically are used to, often comment on market power. I think an interesting implication of our model is that unlike in the standard CES, The elasticity of demand is going to reflect both an intensive margin component and an extensive margin component. So you have your standard intensive margin elasticity of demand. But when you lower your price, you can also get new customers to purchase your product. And that varies substantially over the product space. So the elasticity of demand is always larger than the exogenous elasticity of substitution in the CES preferences. And then it increases substantially as you lower your product rank in the economy. And as you get out to J-star, if you're the marginal product in the economy that's consumed, then your elasticity of demand is infinite. And so you have, you know, a markup of one. So you're just perfectly competitive at that point. We talk about implications for aggregate markups. It turns out that because of the Pareto setup, there's basically two offsetting forces, and they exactly cancel out with each other. And so you end up getting no change in aggregate markups from like an offsetting selection effect, offsetting against a pro-competitive effect from this increase in N. And I'm out of time, so I'll stop with that.